In 1998, a journalist called Lee Strobel published a book called The Case for Christ. It was an effort a fruit of years of gathering information and evidence in an effort to disprove Christianity. He was a staunch atheist, Strobel, and he began his quest after his wife became a Christian. He set out to try and disprove and debunk Christianity. And essentially, the book is a record of his interviews with various scholars and experts, each of whom an expert in different fields related to Christianity. It's a fascinating account, a gripping story, because along the way, and I don't think this is too much a spoiler, but along the way, in his efforts to disprove Christianity, Strobel himself is converted. He becomes a Christian. And it's a fantastic read, especially if you're interested in learning more about the origins, the accuracy of Scripture. It's also an excellent book to give away to someone who's very interested in learning more about Christianity. There's now even a movie based on the book, so there's no excuse, really. But as helpful as reading or watching Strobel's Case for Christ might be, we can do one better this morning. We can do one better. Because we can come to the very Word of God and we can consider the Apostle John's case for Christ. This disciple, the disciple whom Jesus loved, the one who saw him with his own eyes and heard him with his own ears and touched him with his own hands. In these verses this morning, John sets out an irrefutable, undeniable case for Christ. There is something of a courtroom scene to these verses. But it's not us in the dock. It's Jesus. It's Jesus, and it's us, the readers, who are the jury. And John brings witness upon witness before us. And the question put to us is, what will be our verdict on John's case for Christ? So let's think of three things this morning. Firstly, the charge, then the witnesses, then the verdict. If we continue the courtroom analogy, firstly, the charge against Jesus. The charge against Jesus. And this is an important point of background. You should hopefully appreciate throughout this letter, one of the repeated themes has been the importance of believing Jesus as the Christ, the Son of God. It's one of the marks John has held up again and again as proof of being converted. Believing Jesus is the Christ. Over and over, he expresses his concern that his readers believe in Jesus. And not merely believe Jesus existed, but that he who existed was and is, in fact, the Christ, the Son of God. It's clear that he's combating some false views going around in his day, false teachers. They were essentially attacking Christianity with this charge that Jesus was not who he claimed to be. And that was the charge being leveled against the Christians at this time, that Jesus was not who he claimed to be. And these false teachers denied that Jesus was the Son of God. They denied that he was anything more than an ordinary man born to Joseph and Mary. They said he was just a humdrum average man. His death had no more significance than anyone else's death. It's against that charge John is writing. And friends, we should not be so naive to think that this is an historical first century issue. Because today, though 2,000 years later, the very same charge, the very same notions, the very same accusations are being leveled against Jesus. The charge is exactly the same. He is not the Christ, they say. He's not the Son of God. He's not the second person of the Godhead. He's not the Word made flesh. Of course, it'll be repackaged and marketed in another form, but it's essentially the same. This notion that Jesus is no more than an ordinary man. I mean, think of the homes around about us here. How many of the houses in this area, if we were to go and ask them, what do you believe about Jesus? Do you believe Jesus is the Son of God? How many of them would even think that was an important question or not? How many of them would just dismiss the question? And those who would care to respond to the question, how many would say something along the lines, well, if Jesus existed, I can accept he was a good man, maybe a fine teacher, a good example, nothing more. This is the very issue false religions fall down on as well. The deity of Jesus, the divinity of Jesus. So do not think this is a trivial historical matter before us. This has immense relevance to our day-to-day lives as Christians, immense relevance to our evangelism. The question Jesus asked his disciples is pertinent. Mark chapter 8, who do people say I am? Who do people say I am? It's against this charge John is writing, a charge of ordinariness, averageness, bog-standardness. And John brings out witnesses to speak to this charge, expert witnesses. So let's look secondly, getting into the text, the testimony of the witnesses. The testimony of the witnesses. And you'll be able to see in the passage today, the word testimony occurs again and again. And again, it jumps out, really. It's without doubt the key word. And the Greek word, in fact, occurs 10 times in these 7 verses. John is keen to show testimony for Jesus. Testimony that's so strong, we have no reason for rejecting it. That's helpful. Christianity does not call for blind faith. Christianity is not about taking a leap in the dark, friends. If anything, it's the opposite. It's taking a step into the light. And John's encouraging us with these witness-bearing testimonies. He's encouraging us, think this through. Consider the evidence. Look at who Jesus claimed to be. And to make his case, he turns to the testimony of a number of witnesses. Verses 7 and 8 mention 3 that testify, the Spirit, the water, and the blood. I want to suggest he goes further, that he sets before us 5 witnesses in these verses. 5 witnesses, really, coming one by one to take the stand. Firstly, water. Water. Verse 6. This is the one who came by water. And this is not entirely straightforward, friends, what John is meaning here when he speaks of water as a testimony to Jesus. And there is as you can imagine, some elaborate debate among commentators. But most agree this is a reference to Christ's baptism. His baptism. Right at the very start of his ministry, Jesus underwent baptism, water baptism. And in fact, his baptism marked the start of his ministry. It was something of a formal start where Jesus identifies with sinners and he's recognized and anointed from heaven for public ministry. All four gospel writers record it, but Matthew puts it this way, Matthew 3, 16 and 17. When Jesus was baptized, immediately he went up from the water, and behold, the heavens were opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and coming to rest on him. And behold, a voice from heaven said, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased." How does the water of baptism testify to Jesus as being more than an ordinary man? Well, in a very public way, the Spirit came, descending on him, anointing him. In a very audible way, the Father announced and authenticated his identity. "This is my beloved Son," in a very open fashion, in front of a great crowd. So as far as a witness making the case for Christ, John brings the water of Christ's baptism. He was not and is not a mere man, he says. Look at the water of his baptism. He's the Son of God. He's the Lamb of God who came to take away the sin of the world. First, testimony, water. Second, blood. Blood, verse 6. This is he who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ, not by water only, but by water and blood. And this is more straightforward. It speaks of his crucifixion. If Christ's public work was initiated at his baptism, in some ways, it was accomplished at the cross. At the cross. And his death on the cross wasn't an accident. It wasn't a pitiful act of martyrdom. It was a divine, saving, substitutionary death. He was put to death not for his sins, but for the sins of all his people. Jesus came from heaven, and at his baptism, he's identified and approved by the voice of the Father, declaring who he was, what he's about to do. And then at the cross, his blood shed there further testifies that he was and is the Christ. Think of the centurion watching on as Jesus died. His conclusion, surely this man was the Son of God. So more than an ordinary man, his blood is testimony to his uniqueness. Then John adds a third witness. It's the Spirit. The Spirit, verse 6. And the Spirit is the one who testifies because the Spirit is the truth. John develops this. Actually, he gives further help in his gospel accounts. When he quotes Jesus, John 15, verse 26, "When the Helper comes," that's a Spirit, "whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth, who proceeds from the Father," Jesus says, "he will bear witness." He will bear witness about me, or he will testify about me. And it's not just that the Spirit tells the truth, but the Holy Spirit is the truth, as he says here in verse 6. The Spirit who was involved in every moment of Christ's life and ministry. There at his conception. There descending upon him at his baptism. There ministering to him in the wilderness. there in his death, there raising him from the dead. Time and time again, the Spirit testifying to the work and person of Jesus as the Christ, the Son of God. So we have three witnesses making the case so far. Water of his baptism, blood of his death, and the Spirit of truth. John writes, verses 7 and 8, there are three that testify, the Spirit and the water and the blood, and these three agree. These three agree. The number is significant. The Bible is clear. To make any legal case for something, one witness is insufficient. More was needed. According to Deuteronomy 17, Deuteronomy 19, it was necessary for two or three witnesses for a case to be carried. And John might be alluding to that here. These three agree. And isn't it sadly ironic that we can think of witnesses brought against Jesus in his trial before the Sanhedrin, before his death, when he was literally in the dock, and their testimony did not agree. The Bible's very clear. Their testimony did not agree, and yet still he was sentenced to death. And you wonder if John is subtly referring to the contrast there. He's brought forward three witnesses, all agreeing. He goes further. A fourth witness, the Father. The Father, God the Father himself. Verses 9 and 10. If we receive the testimony of men, the testimony of God is greater. For this is a testimony of God, that he is born concerning his Son. Later, verse 10. Whoever does not believe God has made him a liar, because he's not believed in the testimony God has borne concerning his Son. He's arguing from the lesser to the greater. He's saying, if we're prepared to receive the testimony of men, surely we should receive the testimony of God, who is greater. It might help to think of it in everyday life. How do you know that you want to try out that new restaurant? Or how do you know you want to read that particular book? Or how do you know that this summer you want to go on that particular walk or that route that you have never been on before? Well, in most cases, it's because somebody gave you testimony. Somebody bore witness and they said, you've got to try that restaurant. It's absolutely fantastic. You should read this book. I could hardly put it down. Here's this route we went up the Mourns. I never knew it existed before. You should try it sometime. Somebody gave you testimony and you believed them. You've accepted it and you've said, I will act accordingly on your testimony. And John's argument is this. We receive men's testimony all the time. We trust our doctor, our pharmacist, our mechanic, the person who did the electric in your house, and we receive their testimony hardly without a second thought. John says, why will you not accept the truth of what God the Father has said concerning his Son, the testimony God has borne concerning his Son? The real issue this morning, friends, is not that God has provided insufficient evidence. It is that men in their hardness of heart, men and women, have turned their back on the evidence. And they've turned their back on God to go their own way. They don't accept the testimony for the case of Christ because they don't want the testimony for the case for Christ. They would rather have no Christ than admit they need Christ. And John pulls no punches here. He says, verse 10, to such people who reject this testimony, you are calling God a liar. A liar. To deny these things about Jesus is to call the Father a liar. That's how wicked unbelief is, friends. That's how wicked false religions are. As friendly as they might be, Jehovah's Witnesses, Mormons, Muslims, Hindus, they're calling God a liar. The indisputable evidence God has brought to show who Jesus is, proving beyond all reasonable doubt, it's indisputable, and to reject it is not unreasonable, it's not uncharitable, it is unbelief. It's unbelief. John Stott puts it, unbelief isn't a misfortune to be pitied. It is a terrible sin. A terrible sin, the sin of unbelief. It is not neutral. It is sinful. The person who rejects God's clear testimony is willfully blaspheming their maker, their sustainer, and ultimately their judge. And surely that's not something you want to do when you're going to stand before him on the last day. If in the face of all the evidence you're saying today, well, still not for me, not for me, no thank you. I am not interested, not my thing. I will take a polite pass on Jesus. That's a terrible sin. A terrible sin. The evidence is staggering, and to reject it, John says, is calling God a liar. That's at the heart of unbelief. You're saying, no, God, what you say is not true. You're calling God a liar. Four witnesses so far, the water, blood, spirit, and then the Father. Then fifthly, ourselves. Ourselves, a little phrase in verse 10. Whoever believes in the Son of God has the testimony in himself. In himself. It's been external witnesses so far, but John now turns to a witness that Christians have within themselves. What we believe and confess with our lips, God makes real in our hearts. In other words, when we trust this Jesus as the Son of God, God helps us to know in our hearts that these things are true. God helps us to know that Jesus is who he said he is. And maybe you've heard all these witnesses laid forth and you've thought to yourself, you know, I'm not that troubled about this because I just know that Jesus is the Son of God. I know it in here. That's exactly the point John's making. This couldn't be the only testimony that he brings. It's kept until last, but he does place a degree of weight, this internal subjective testimony. We could think of Romans 8, verse 16. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. So one of the reasons you can know Jesus is the Son of God is that you just know it in your heart. You know it in your heart. It's something an unbeliever just can't relate to, can't identify to. But this inner conviction that these things are true, and they're true for you personally. So I ask you, do you have this witness in your heart this morning, this testimony within yourself that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, that he's your sin bearer, that he took your sin, your sorrows, your iniquities? Whoever believes in the Son of God has the testimony in himself. So John set forth his case for Christ. We've had the charge of ordinariness. John has brought witness upon witness, five of them making the case. Jesus is not an ordinary man. He is way, way more. He's the Son of God. Let's come thirdly to the verdict. The verdict we all must consider. The verdict, and the verdict is one of life and death. But strangely, it's not a matter of life and death for the individual in the dock. It's not a matter of life and death for Jesus. It's actually a matter of life and death for those sitting in the jury. It's a matter of eternal life and eternal death. Verse 11, this is the testimony that God gave us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Reminding us, eternal life, it's not a prize any of us wins. It's not something we sign up to or choose for ourselves. It's a gift. God gave eternal life. A gift. A gift found in Jesus. This life is in his Son. Verse 12. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son does not have life. It could not be much clearer than that, friends. To have the Son is to have life. And to not have the Son of God means you do not have this life. It's an either-or scenario. He who has the Son has life, eternal blessedness, life forever with God. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have that kind of life. No matter what else they might have, no matter how religious they might be, if they have not received the Son, they don't have life. And that's the issue, is it not? Either you have him or you don't have him. Either you know Jesus Christ or you don't know him. There's no fence, no middle ground. It's one or the other. So what is your verdict when it comes to the case for Christ? Do you believe in Jesus as the Son of God, the only Redeemer of men, women, boys and girls? Or will you continue to ignore all the evidence and call God a liar? That's an important question. It's the most important question of your life. What's your verdict when it comes to the case for Christ? You know, there's nothing better than trusting in Jesus as the Son of God, and taking him at his word and allowing God to be God, acknowledging that you don't know everything, but that you know Jesus and he knows you. There's nothing better. Is that the testimony in your heart? If it is, what about all those people you'll meet this week who do not have this testimony in their heart? The risen Lord Jesus said to his disciples, "You will be my witnesses. You will be my witnesses." The job of a witness is to ring out. In the face of such powerful witness testimony before us this morning, may God help each one of us to go and be witnesses ourselves. Amen. Let's pray together. Will you join me as we stand for prayer? Lord, we thank you for the amazing relevance of these words. The issue is still the same today. repackaged and rebranded in different forms and different packages, but still essentially the same. And so we thank you for this loud, clear reminder that Jesus is the Christ, the anointed Son of God. We thank you for the witness bearing testimonies before us in your word today. The water of his baptism, the blood of his crucifixion, the Spirit of truth, the Father himself, and then even, O Lord, our inner testimonies crying out the same. And so, Lord, we thank you that it is beyond all doubts Jesus is the Christ. We pray for any this morning, skeptical, doubting, wavering. We pray for those deliberately disobeying and choosing unbelief over and against belief. Lord, we ask that you would have mercy and that you would soften and renew and change hearts that they might believe Jesus is the Son of God. This is our prayer for those we come in contact with, especially those near and dear to us who don't know you and have turned their back on you. Help us to be witnesses and to ring out to the validity of the claims of Jesus upon their lives. So, Lord, help us and go with us, we pray. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen. Well, Psalm 2 is another psalm that bears witness to the divinity of the Lord Jesus Christ. Psalm 2, as we sing verses 1 to 5 and 8, we use the tune 2-3-5. Psalm 2, verses 1 to 5 and 8. It begins and it recollects the deliberate unbelief of world leaders, verses 1 and 2. But then verses 4 and 5, you have the testimony again of the Father. Verse 4, yet according to my will, I have set my king to reign, and on Zion's holy hill, my anointed, my Messiah, I'll maintain. Verse 5, his decree I will make known, he to me had this to say, you're a son to me indeed, I've begotten you this day. And the psalm closes in verse 8 with the call to kiss the Son, bow the knee, embrace and show allegiance to the Lord Jesus, the Son of God. Psalm 2 then, 1 to 5 and 8, we stand to praise God together.